Crowing, expressing great pride or triumph, especially in a tone of gloating satisfaction. Crowing.
It's a big green light for us to build more coal mines, supply the world more coal.
I saw Chairman Sharma up there. Oh, and he looks so earnest and he's, you know, almost tears in his eyes.
Why don't you make that your target?
Because you're going to get the 35%.
Because our policy is to meet and beat. That's what we do.
But while some in the government bask in the post-Glasglow, others are feeling the pressure.
About 40 to 45% target of emissions reductions by 2035. It's a modest stretch, but it's not a big stretch.
Look, personally, I would like us, for a whole bunch of reasons, to at least move our target to where our projections are.
Moderate Liberals like Dave Sharma and Jason Falinski, all too aware of how the government's Glasgow efforts, or lack thereof, could come back to bite them in seats like theirs. Seats an army of cashed-up climate campaigning independents have in their sights.
The big idea with Climate 200 is to get the right people in Parliament so we can start to make progress on the big issues like climate change, integrity and gender equity.
It's a big idea with big bucks to back it up. Climate advocate and son of Australia's first billionaire, Simon Holmesacourt, pulling together a $4 million campaign war chest via his fundraising group, Climate 200.
We aren't looking for candidates and we're not starting campaigns. What we're doing is seeing where these campaigns are rising up and where they have excellent candidates coming forward and helping them to level the playing field.
The money will be used very strategically on winnable seats, targeting low-hanging fruit like Dave Sharma in Wentworth, Trent Zimmerman in North Sydney and Jason Falinski in McKellar, Greg Hunt in Flinders, Tim Wilson in Goldstein and Josh Frydenberg in Kooyong, also on the extensive hit list.
Inner city Liberals are very, very vulnerable to the climate message at the moment. So you have people who are traditional Liberal voters, but who are very, very worried about the environment, about global warming, about climate change. And they are the seats that the Liberals are very, very worried about.
Well, we know we're making an impact because MPs are petitioning the Prime Minister, unfortunately to no avail, to make progress on climate change. We've even had federal members, including the Treasurer, call donors to Climate 200 and monster them for supporting us.
Last election, the campaign claimed one very big scalp. Climate 200-backed Zali Steggall in New South Wales, along with fellow independents Helen Haynes in Victoria and Rebecca Sharkey in South Australia, all claiming victory.
Look, the 2019 election was a very hard-fought election. Really, many felt that the Liberal Party and the coalition had moved on and no longer represented them. So, yes, climate was a very important one.
I will be a climate leader for you.
That led to change in Warringah. And I really hope that we have inspired change all across the nation.
This time round, there are set to be even more contenders. Dozens of voices of and voices for community groups popping up around the country.
These grassroots organisations are ultimately just communities that are saying we've had enough.
It is a growing movement in Australia that comes from a foundation of basically of success, and that's what they're building on.
It wouldn't take much to change the game in Canberra.
Our parliament is so finely balanced that if just two or three of these community independents can get up, then it's a very different parliament.
At the moment, a very small group of people within the government are controlling climate policy, but that could flip whenever we go to the election.
The crossbench could hold the balance of power. That would mean an entirely new future ahead for Australia, and it would absolutely rewrite the next 10 years.
Momentum is on their side, both locally, where votes for minor parties and independents are at an all-time high, and globally, where pressure for climate action is at an all-time high ahead of next year's COP, where countries have agreed to revisit their 2030 emissions reduction targets.
Well, all that happened at COP26 was all countries noted a request to revisit these things.
We're going to say we're going to review them, we're not going to do it. Sorry, like that's...
But that means...
The Nationals did not sign it, PK, OK? I did not sign it.
I've been very clear about what our target is.
Displays like that only adding fuel to the fire in what could turn out to be a killer blow for coalition candidates in climate-conscious seats.
We're hearing a lot from lapsed Liberals and they see the impasse on climate. They're very frustrated that, you know, say if you vote Dave Sharma, you're really getting Barnaby for free. So unless the coalition starts moving back towards the values of people in these heartland seats, they're going to lose them.
The amount that politicians care about doing something about climate change depends much more on re-election than it does on what's actually good for the planet. So the only way that they're ever going to care is if they lose seats and if they end up in a pickle where they're having to negotiate with independents. So this needs to happen for something to be done. Otherwise, we're still going to be having this conversation in another 5 years.
Yeah, you're right. It comes down entirely to votes. I think what's interesting is that you get the sense the Libs are actually worried about it. Like, the whole net zero thing. I mean, it's a bit about Glasgow, obviously, but I don't think they need to make that pivot unless they're worried about this. But I would just warn, we've heard this script before, before the last election and the one before that. One day it might come true. We'll see.